Westbow Press proudly presents the abridged audio dramatization of Mountaintop by Robert Whitlow. Mysterious visions appear to be more cursed than blessing when they land Sam Miller in jail for a crime he did not commit. The lawyer turned minister who represents Miller must uncover the truth about the vision's origin and meaning. A compelling southern legal thriller from best-selling author and practicing attorney Robert Whitlow. And now, Mountaintop by Robert Whitlow, narrated by Reg Platt. Chapter 1. Sam Miller did his best work while asleep. Several nights each week, he had night visions more vivid than movies, and spiritual dreams so real he could smell the fragrance of heaven. Muriel never stirred. Sam rolled over and opened his blue eyes. He ran his hand over his closely cropped white hair and reached for the tattered notebook on the nightstand beside the bed. Some of the pages listed information about customers. The Smiths wanted their grass cut and patio edged before a party on Friday night. The Blevins had decided to plant daylilies along the back of their property line. Other sheets recorded what Sam had seen and heard during the night. Faces of people who lived in Shelton with needs as diverse as salvation for a wayward child to money for an overdue car payment. Sam sat up and rested his feet on the threadbare rug that covered part of the bedroom floor. He opened the notebook to a blank page. At the top he wrote the date and the words, "Within 3 months, you'll see your son." He shuffled into the kitchen and looked out the window above the sink. Their small house rested atop a knoll positioned like a step stool before the Blue Ridge Mountains. Sam leaned over and smelled the crisp morning air through a narrow gap at the bottom of the window. Weather ruled his business, and winter's schedule was less rigorous. Sam always made the morning coffee. As the coffee started dripping into the pot, he returned to the bedroom. Muriel was out of bed and wrapped in her housecoat. Sam leaned over and kissed the top of her head. Sam showered and scraped his chin free of stubble. Buttoning his shirt, he could smell the sausage in the skillet. His stomach rumbled in anticipation. The cupboard at the Miller house didn't look like a grocery store shelf. Mason jars of green beans, tomatoes, okra, squash, and yellow corn cut from the cob filled the narrow space. Sam's garden was legendary. 2 acres on the flat spot at the bottom of the driveway produced more than enough to feed the Millers and provide extra income through the sale of fresh produce to Sam's customers. Sam came into the kitchen, gave Muriel a hug, and rubbed his cheek against hers.
"The biscuits are in the oven." "I want to take a biscuit and sausage to Barry Porter," Sam said. "He's going to deliver 2 loads of pine bark mulch to a job this morning."
Sam sat at the small kitchen table and watched Muriel's morning routine. Every movement had meaning. She didn't waste energy or ingredients.
"How is Barry's boy doing?" Muriel asked. "He ran off with a married woman to Florida, but I saw him turning toward home the other night. I'm going to remind Barry to keep looking down the road and welcome him back when he repents."
Muriel opened the oven door and took out 4 golden biscuits.
"Why don't you take Barry 2 biscuits, she suggested. "You eat one and I'll nibble on the other."
Sam scratched his head.
"Only 1 for me. I don't want to pass out while I'm spreading the mulch around Mrs. Smith's patio. I need all my strength to lift that shovel." "I'm thinking about the extra weight these biscuits and sausage are causing around that stomach of yours," she said. "I love babying you, but sometimes I feel guilty fixing what you want all the time."
Sam grinned.
"Don't worry. The gravy cuts the calories in half."
After all the food was on the table, she sat down across from him. They bowed their heads. Sam prayed for Barry's son, moved into his usual blessing over the meal, and concluded with,
"And Master, please take all the cholesterol out of this fine breakfast. Amen."
After breakfast, Sam put on a heavy coat and went outside. The sun was a large yellow ball in the east. Sam kept the utility trailer he used to haul his equipment in a small storage shed. Parked in front of the shed was a dented red pickup truck with the words, "Sam Miller, Lawn Maintenance," written on both doors in white paint. Sam unlocked the door of the shed and went inside. The familiar odors of gasoline and dry grass greeted him. He placed a rake, shovel, and other hand tools into a rack around the front of the trailer and secured everything with a strap. As he stepped away from the building, movement at the bottom of the driveway caught his eye. A Barlow County sheriff's car turned into his driveway. The car pulled up to his front door and stopped. 2 deputies got out.
"Morning, Sam," the older of the 2 men called out.
It was Lamar Cochran, the chief deputy. Sam and Muriel had known the Cochran family for years.
"Howdy, Lamar," Sam said. "Who's your running mate?" "This is Vic Morris," Cochran replied. "He grew up in Hendersonville and joined us a few months ago."
Sam wiped his hand on his pants and extended it to Morris.
Good to meet you, Sam said. Morris hesitated a moment before shaking Sam's hand. Don't have any biscuits to offer you, Sam said to the two men. Muriel won't make any extra because she knows where they'll end up. Sam patted his stomach. I need to talk serious with you, Cochrane replied. Come inside. I'm always here to help.
Sam turned away and climbed the three steps to the front stoop. The three men entered the small living room. Sam stuck his head in the kitchen.
Lamar Cochrane and a young deputy named Vic Morris are here, he said.
Muriel wrapped her house coat more tightly around herself and came to the doorway. Cochrane nodded to her. Muriel gave him a big smile.
Hey, Lamar, she said. How's your mama? Not doing so well. Her sugar is messing her up big time, and my brother and I had to put her in the nursing home. Well, I have to get down to see her.
Don't, Muriel, Cochrane interrupted, looking at the floor. This isn't a social call. Sam tilted his head to the side.
What do you mean?
Cochrane nodded towards Morris, who pulled a sheet of paper from his back pocket.
Mr. Miller, this is a warrant for your arrest, Morris said. We're here to take you to jail.
Chapter 2. Reverend Michael James Andrews didn't take Mondays off.
Why would you need a day to relax? Asked Bobby Lambert, one of Mike's former law partners and an elder at the Little Creek Church. You only work 1 hour a week. Every day but Sunday you can tell folks that you're going to pray, then slip out the back door to the golf course.
I can't ignore the eternal peril of my current clients, Mike replied. Take you, for example. Convincing the Almighty to have mercy on your wretched soul is harder than getting Judge Coburg to grant a temporary restraining order. Every time I come up with an argument in your favor, you find new and creative ways to sin.
Mike's regular day away from the office was Friday. After almost 10 years as a trial lawyer, the brown-haired, broad-shouldered minister continued to view Monday as a normal workday. By Thursday morning, he'd written and practiced his sermon several times, so there wasn't much to do but wait for Sunday morning at 11:25 a.m. to deliver it. Mike never felt guilty walking down a broad fairway on Friday afternoons. However, golf was an expensive pastime, and on a minister's salary, Mike didn't have the money to pay green fees and rent a cart whenever he had the urge to play around. So while in seminary, he took up mountain biking. When his wife Peg questioned the change, he told her he'd rather elevate his heart rate pedaling up a steep hill than in frustration over a 5-foot putt that rimmed out of the cup. Little Creek Church was located 50 yards from the small rocky stream that gave the church its name. For over 140 years, the congregation of independent Presbyterians averaged 50 to 100 members, with the graveyard behind the church being the only part of the church that steadily grew. When Mike decided to leave law practice in Shelton and become a minister, the Little Creek elders followed his progress through seminary in Virginia and issued a call as soon as he graduated. Questions about his lack of experience vanished after doubters heard him preach. The small white sanctuary couldn't handle the crowds. Some of the older members fought the building program, but within a year and a half, a new sanctuary stood like a big brother next to the old one. The old sanctuary became a wedding chapel and funeral parlor. Mike's office was at the back corner of an administrative wing connected to the new sanctuary. Mike put down a book about how to be an effective minister in a changing community and looked at the large clock on the wall. It was 11:15 a.m., and he'd only had 2 phone calls all morning. There was a light knock on his door. Come in, he said. Dolores Killian, the 60-year-old church secretary, stuck her head into the office. A widow and holdover from the old guard, one of Mike's early triumphs, had been winning her support.
Someone is here to see you, Dolores whispered in a husky voice that revealed a 40-year love affair with cigarettes.
Who is it? I'm having lunch in Shelton with a man who visited the church on Sunday and need to leave in a few minutes.
Muriel Miller. She's not a member of the church. Her husband is in jail and she wants you to go see him.
Mike waved his hand. I'll talk to her on my way out.
During his legal career, Mike handled criminal cases and interacted with scores of men wearing orange jumpsuits, handcuffs, and leg irons. Since becoming a minister, he'd not visited the jail and ignored the squat gray building a couple of blocks from the courthouse. He returned to his book. It was an interesting chapter. After checking his hair in a small mirror beside the door several minutes later, he walked into the reception area where he was startled by the sight of a small, gray-haired woman with a wrinkled face. She sat on the edge of a small sofa and wrung a tissue in her hands. She looked up at him anxiously.
Oh, Mike began. You're Mrs. Miller, Dolores said. Her husband is in jail, Mike finished. I'm sorry to hear that.
Muriel stood and Mike shook her hand.
Reverend Andrews, would you visit my husband? He's been in jail for almost 3 months.
Do I know him?
His name is Sam Miller. We live off McAfee Road. He has a lawn care business.
Mike thought for a moment, but couldn't connect the name with a face. Muriel continued, "He told me you were a good lawyer."
"Well, not for over 6 years. I represented a lot of people when I practiced law, but I don't remember your husband."
"Oh, he's never gone to see a lawyer in his life."
"Well, then why contact me?"
Muriel lowered her eyes and spoke in a soft voice.
"He had a dream Saturday night and saw you coming to see him at the jail."
Mike's jaw dropped open slightly. Dolores leaned forward in her chair.
"Excuse me," Mike said. "Could you explain what you just said?"
Muriel sighed.
"Sam has lots of dreams. The Lord shows him things that are going to happen and stuff about people who he's supposed to pray for."
Her voice grew stronger.
"It's nothing that doesn't happen in the Bible. Jacob had a dream and saw angels on a ladder."
"I know the Bible," Mike interrupted.
"Of course you do," Muriel responded quietly. "I just didn't want you to think Sam was a nut."
Mike caught Dolores rolling her eyes out of the corner of his vision.
"I'll walk out with you."
Mike opened the door for Muriel. It was a warm but pleasant spring day.
"Why is your husband in jail?" "He hasn't done anything wrong."
It had been years since Mike heard that familiar line.
"I understand, but he must have been charged with something." "They claim he took money from the church, but it's either a lie or a big mistake."
"Embezzlement?"
"Yes, that's the word."
"Which church?"
"Craig Valley. Little place not far from the house. Sam was filling in as their preacher for a few months when they looked for a new man to take over."
"Is that your home church?"
"Not really. We move from church to church as the Lord directs."
Mike glanced sideways at the strange remark. They reached his car. Beside his car sat a red pickup truck with Miller's name on the side.
"My sympathies are with you, and I'll pray for your husband, but I'm not the man you need. You should hire a practicing lawyer who can request bail. If your husband hasn't given a statement to the police, tell him to keep his mouth shut until he talks to an attorney."
Satisfied with his succinct and accurate counsel, Mike opened the door of his car. Muriel didn't move.
"Good luck," Mike said. "Don't forget the dream," Muriel responded.
Mike slid into the car and looked up at her.
"Believe me, I won't."
Chapter 3. The road from Little Creek Church to Shelton followed the winding course of a valley nestled between two wooded ridges. Three times the road crossed a bold flowing stream before climbing over one of the ridges and dipping into town. Mike and Peg's house was on a street near the top of a ridge. Childless, their only house guest was Judge, an 8-year-old Hungarian Vizslaw. Mike drove down the hill into town. Shelton had 12 traffic lights. Each light had a number on a tiny sign above it that provided a convenient way to give directions. Mike parked on the west side of the courthouse square, across the street from the law firm formerly known as Forrest, Andrews & Lambert, the most respected law firm in Barlow County. The gold letters over the front door now read Forrest, Lambert, Park & Arnold. Mike entered the Ash Street Cafe. He nodded in the direction of Butch Niles, the manager of the trust department for the Bank of Barlow County and a popular young representative in the General Assembly.
"Hello, preacher," said Niles, slapping Mike on the back.
"Why don't you join me?" he asked. "The regulars will be here in a few minutes. We'll argue politics, but it won't amount to anything."
No thanks. I have an appointment."
Other members of the legal and business community drifted into the cafe. Mike looked at his watch and inwardly kicked himself for not confirming his appointment. He checked his PDA, but hadn't entered a contact number. He looked at the table where Niles and his cronies were sitting. There weren't any empty seats. Everyone else in the cafe was preoccupied with lunch and conversation. Mike suddenly wanted to get out of the restaurant. After one more glance at his watch, he turned to the blonde-haired woman behind the cash register.
Sue, if a man comes in looking for me, tell him I waited as long as I could, but I had to leave for another appointment."
"Sure thing, Mike."
Mike breathed a sigh of relief when he stood on the sidewalk. Walking down the sidewalk towards his car, he muttered, "I don't have another appointment." No one was harmed by his misstatement, but it still made him feel uneasy. He stopped. He could visit the jail and make his statement true. He began walking slowly down the street toward the jail. The visitor's waiting area hadn't changed in 6 years. Mike knocked on the glass for a small opening in the wall. A young female deputy slid it open.
"May I help you?" she asked pleasantly.
"I'm Mike Andrews. I'd like to talk with a prisoner named Sam Miller."
"Visiting hours are Wednesday evening from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m., Saturday morning from 9 a.m. to noon, and Sunday afternoon from 1 p.m. to 4 p.m.
"Oh, I'm a minister," Mike said. "Mr. Miller's wife asked me to visit him."
"That doesn't change the rules."
Mike hesitated. "I'm also a lawyer."
The woman's eyes narrowed.
"Do you have a picture ID in your attorney card?"
Mike took out his wallet and handed over his driver's license and state bar association card. He'd maintained his law license by paying a small annual fee and attending a yearly seminar at the coast where he took enough classes to satisfy his continuing legal education requirement. The woman disappeared with the items. Finally, she reappeared, joined by a familiar face.
"Mike Andrews," bellowed Chief Deputy Lamar Cochran. "What brings you down here?"
"Hey, Lamar, nothing different. Still pretending to be a lawyer."
"It's okay," Cochran said to the woman deputy. "Mr. Andrews practiced law before he went preaching. Let him in."
An electric buzzer sounded, and Mike pulled open the metal door. Cochran waited for him on the other side. The two men shook hands.
"You kept your law license?" Cochran asked.
"Yeah, once you pass the bar exam, it's hard to give it up." Mike followed Cochran into the booking area.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.